Live from FedEx Forum in the American Home Shield Studio, this is the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Presented by Direct Auto Insurance. Now, here's your host, Chris Vernon.
On GrindCityMedia.com, it's Chris Vernon Show. Welcome, 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 welcome. It is the Friday. What day is it? The 7th? September 7th, 2019 edition of the show. Today on the show, the band Camino has sold out Minglewood Hall tonight. They are on the Heat Seekers chart on Billboard today. And before they play that show tonight over at Minglewood, they are going to join us in studio coming up in our next segment. Brian Edwards from Vegas Insider has some games he loves this weekend and will hopefully give us some winners. He'll join us at 12:35. And then at 1 o'clock, Vinnie Verno coming off his ridiculous 3-1 week where the only loss was the Northwestern bad beat. He's got some Mortal Locks, Massacres, and Bloodbaths today. Got a big college football weekend, and week one of the NFL is ahead. We'll get to all that. It's nice outside. Smile. Let's do it. Turn it up! Hope everybody's having a good day. Neither of you two clowns corrected me. It's the 6th. It's the 6th of September. It's not the 7th yet. The 7th is tomorrow. The NFL did get started last night, and it was vomitous. We'll get to that here in a moment. First, I'll welcome John Roser to the show. Maybe. John Roser. A.K.A. the Cologne Ranger, A.K.A. the Body Spray Bandit, A.K.A. Senior Sack, Johnny Backpole, Johnny Bearcat, A.K.A. John Snozer, the Grim Roser, John Pistol, Johnny Falcon. What up?
What up, what up, what up?
Devin Walker's here, the microphone mangler himself. Black Phelps, Senior Quasadilla.
Yeah!
How many times?
He has been carrying around that damn football helmet all day.
Yeah, why are you carrying around a football
helmet?
He
was wearing it.
I was going to wear it on the show.
He was wearing it.
I realized I couldn't talk through it.
So what do you mean you can't talk through it?
I mean, it would be hard for him to talk through a helmet on the show.
You don't have a mouthpiece in.
Yeah.
I might try it when we come back.
You kind of mumble anyway.
Yeah. When Vinnie Verno pops up, I'll pop
Oh, that'd be good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I thought you might have had a head injury that took place over the course of the last 24 hours.
Yeah,
no?
When it happened, I called somebody a cracker.
So,
on
2K. How many times in your life have you called someone a cracker?
In my life. In 25 years. How many? Probably like once.
You think one time?
It was probably like the cracker-ass cracker one, too, so it counts as twice.
You didn't do it, like, vociferously. You weren't angered.
No, I wasn't.
And
mad.
Then said that. Oh, okay.
It was just like out of like a, hey, cracker-ass cracker?
Josina Anderson reports.
Oh, God, we got more going on with Antonio Brown?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
All right.
More beef.
He called Mike Mayock a cracker. His GM. He
so
called
funny.
Him a cracker.
That's so funny.
Dude, what's better is watching, like, the people that, like, you know, they have. Like,
oh,
well,
God.
Once you become, like, you're the woke guy.
And what are the woke guys doing?
No, when you're woke and you're politically correct as all get out, then you have to be
gotta break it down.
Very offended by that.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
You have to be. He should apologize immediately. And in fact, he should apologize to everyone. You know, how can you be in the same locker room with Derek Carr When Derek Carr knows the way you feel about white people,
I mean, he's a cracker too.
Like, that's how woke you have to be, right? Like,
I cannot wait to see the woke people debate,
dude,
this.
Dude, all right.
No, like, how does this work? Jemele Hill's next column on The Atlantic.
There is nothing funnier to me than him calling Mike Mayock a cracker. And evidently, Mike Mayock did not take great offense and was like trying to calm the thing down.
How could you?
And, dude,
I mean,
I would.
Dude, I got called a honky in the Wolf Chase parking lot by a Cuban guy named Israel.
No,
yes. There's levels. There's
wait, hold on. You know way too much about who called you a honky.
So I know I can remember exactly how this happened. So.
I would actually be more offended by honky.
No, I backed into his car. Now, here's the thing. I'm probably 23 years old.
Right.
Oh, you deserve that.
Yeah, something like that.
You deserve that.
And I look behind me. Nobody's behind me. I'm listening to My Mind Playing Tricks on Me by the Ghetto Boys.
Of course you are.
Remember exactly how this is going. Back out. This is back in the days when you made a mix on a CD. Yeah. So that was just the song
Johnny
on the mix.
Yep.
On the hot mix. Yeah. So I'm back
doing honky-ish.
Just listening to the Ghetto Boys at Wolf Chase outside Macy's, backing out of my parking spot. And this dude just comes flying up, and I, of course, don't see it. I have my cars already out of the parking spot. Hit him, and he just goes, effing honky! He calls me a honky, and I'm like, look, dude, I'm sorry. He's like, gonna call the police. I'm like, dude, you can call the police, but we're in a private parking lot, and the cops aren't gonna come here, which is true. We call the cops. Cops are like, you're in the Wolf Chase parking lot. Cops aren't coming there.
Yeah, they are.
Yes, what are you talking about?
No, they don't.
They show up all the time,
yeah,
bro.
What planet are you
on? Have
you
not been to the Wolf Chase Mall?
Literally.
Well, they do now. No, all right? They were not all around the Wolf Chase Mall back then.
This was in the 1930s, bro. This is
No,
literally called me yesterday or texted me.
Yeah,
they
were in the Laurelwood parking lot, yeah. They were in Laurelwood.
They're in parking lots everywhere, Roser.
I'm just telling you.
They have a freaking tower in the parking lot.
They will not take like an accident traffic
report. Yes, they will.
Okay, well, they wouldn't. They told me they would not come. We got on the phone with them. They said they would not come. Which works out for me, because there's probably about $700 worth of damage to this dude's car. And he's like, well, I need some money. And I'm like,
oh, he needs money from
me. Oh, yeah. And I'm like,
accent,
I'm like, all right, dude, I can give you. I was like, I can give you $200. And he's like, all right. And then he exchanges phone numbers with. We exchange phone numbers. He calls my phone. Yeah, that's my number. I give him the $200. Dude, never hear from him again. Dude went in that mall and bought him some clothes.
Wait.
100% what he did with
you
the
$200. You gave him $200?
I gave him the $200 to help get his car fixed, yeah.
In cash?
I got out of that easy, though. Otherwise, I owe the dude freaking $700.
That's true. I really want
to $200 to just make that go away and never have to hear from him again.
I want
to
ask y'all, though, on the level of insults, where does Cracker, like, line up? Like, there's Cracker, there's Honky. Like, what else is, like,
White Devil?
White Devil. Like, where is that?
White Devil.
Where are we going with white insults?
Like, what else is? I don't know. What else is?
Where do y'all, like, where is the line? Like,
I'm offended by none of them.
Oh.
None of them offend me.
Really?
I find them funny.
Yeah.
If I'm walking in the street and somebody goes, White Devil? I mean, dude, I'm laughing at that.
Because you think it's like Chappelle, like, kind of made that one a thing. So, like, it's kind of
maybe,
funny.
You're
not offended by any of them?
I
like,
mean,
what's y'all's, like, my word?
I don't think there isn't one.
There isn't one for y'all?
No.
There isn't one.
Right. I mean, I would just.
Dude, like, when the guy called, when Israel,
honky,
the Cuban, called me a honky, like, I'm almost like, what? Who calls someone?
He had to dig
I would be offended by that.
You stupid honky?
Yeah. Yeah, because I'd be like, okay, like that. I think like Cracker. this is a woke conversation. I feel like Cracker.
We're woke, bro.
I feel like that is said. Like, there's no way there cannot be a tinge of humor in it, right?
Yeah.
I feel like somebody that. Like says honky in a like a dogmatic tone.
Does not like white people.
Yeah, like it's not humorous at all to them. Like they really hate white people. Like you can't cause anybody else that says that word would be laughing while they're saying it. It's such a preposterous thing to say. But I would almost like feel like I feel like I'm offended now because you're so serious about this word. Like you're saying it like I should be taking it seriously.
Cracker.
No, crack.
Honky.
Like,
honky. You talking about honky?
Yes. Honk. It's such a
preposterous word.
It is a ridiculous word.
You honky.
I mean, in his defense,
you're gonna call your girlfriend a honky?
I'm a pasty white guy listening to my mind's playing tricks on me. Some honky-ish right there, man. Yeah, that's honky.
I'm gonna tell you this. If there is one cracker we need to talk about today, it's Mitchell Trubisky.
Yeah. This guy sucks.
Oh my god.
The cracker that can't throw the ball.
This
anywhere.
Guy, like what? This is. You remember how we used to talk all the time about how it was malpractice for the New Orleans Pelicans to be able to draft Anthony Davis and then build around him with like. You know, Etwan Moore. like the best player ever played with was Drew Holiday
Darius
in the one
Miller.
Season he was healthy. Yeah, it was just malpractice what they did, right? And I was watching that last night, and I'm thinking to myself, dude, it is bona fide malpractice for them to have that quarterback with that defense.
Yes.
That defense, and you watch Khalil Mack, and you're going, like, if you're the Raiders, you got to be sitting back and being like what? What did we spend our money on? Like, he wrecks every offensive line. He's always doing something to screw you up.
We got rid of a franchise defensive player who does everything right to then trade for a franchise offensive player who is a complete prick.
Who calls our GM a honky.
Calls our GM
a cracker. Anyway.
He can't find a helmet to wear.
Yeah, so you're watching that last night. Look. I like their weapons, too. The Montgomery kid looked pretty good.
Yes, he's on my fantasy team.
Tarik Cohen, I love him. Robinson's a player. Anthony Miller's a player. I mean, they got guys. They got weapons.
I almost thought, because, look, again, like Trubisky doesn't play in the preseason, so they don't get to work any of this timing stuff out. And I thought the same thing. They got a lot of weapons. But, like, he doesn't really quite know how to use everything yet. Like,
what?
First of all these guys are not going to be able to play this much during the season. Like, you're going to have to whittle some of this down and who are going to be your main guys in the rotation, who are going to be your main guys out there all the time. Now, Allen Robinson was out there like 96% of the play, so we know he is.
All I know, he stinks.
Yeah, he does suck.
He stinks.
Is he Blake Bortles North?
I don't know.
He is.
Blake Bortles North?
Blake Bortles did say, now he's with the Rams, he said, this is the first time I've been coached since I've been in the NFL.
Oh, stop already.
Wait, time out. What?
Stop already. Yeah. Blake Bortles, he was on with the guys from Part of My Day, and he said that he bought a Tesla so he'd stop dipping because then he wouldn't have to drive to the gas station. Right? And now he just, and then he said, but it didn't work. So now I just drive to the gas station in a Tesla.
This is the guy.
What?
Yeah, exactly.
That's who we're dealing with.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Blake Bortles. Right.
Yeah.
That guy.
So slow down. Mitch Trubisky's awful. I actually went and pulled up their depth chart last night. I'm like, surely they got somebody who can complete a pass longer than 2 yards, and it's Chase Daniel. I swear to God. Chase Daniel played in Missouri in like the 60s.
Yeah,
he did.
He has been around forever. He was the Chiefs backup for 100 years.
Yeah, he was.
He was there when like Brody Croyle was so long ago.
There when Norm Stewart was coaching the basketball
team. I was like,
team.
Man, Chase Daniel, like that. So there isn't really somebody to just say, hey, put him in. Maybe he could complete a pass.
He can throw the ball, though.
The other thing is Trubisky, as if it's not bad enough.
Dude, he just stares down the guy he wants to throw to.
Oh, okay,
dude has no idea how to
But you want to make
defense.
It like 100 times worse? You got one guy who was the first guy, like I think I read last night in NFL history, to have a 100 quarterback rating 2 years in a row to start his career, and that's Deshaun Watson. Passed on him. Traded up and passed on him.
Yeah.
And then friggin' Mahomes threw 50 touchdowns last year.
Bad job evaluating right there the scouting department.
Yikes. As if it weren't bad enough, you've got that kind of hanging out there where you're looking around at two guys that got drafted, what, like 10 slots later?
Yeah.
Both are amazing franchise quarterbacks, and you're stuck with Mitch Trubisky and this defense that is just
– I mean, they are
– they are unbelievable,
ferocious.
Man. Like, the only thing they hit was, like, that one super long pass, right? Like, that's how it felt like throughout the game. And then Jimmy Graham posting up on somebody. He can at least still do that.
He can still post you
He's
up.
He's still 6'8", and can shield you off, right, and catch a pass in the end zone.
It's like if you're the Bears, it's you know that's coming. You know, Rodgers got the touchdown they got, it was like a 4-play 74-yard drive and they got the big bomb. It's like you know that's going to happen at least once or twice a game if you can't score points against him. Yeah. You know Rodgers is gonna do that at
Eventually,
least once or twice. Something
yes.
he's gonna make something happen.
Look, that so I walk away from that game, and I don't even – it wasn't like I was mega impressed with the Packers either.
No, walk away. We talked Mitch Trubisky was horrible.
That's it.
Yeah. I was like playing 2K.
He's going to hold them back.
Dude,
okay.
The game was boring.
Yeah, so you got 2K last night. I got it this morning.
Yeah.
Give me an instant review.
It's amazing.
You text me last night and told me John Morant is amazing on the thing.
He is. He's unguardable.
That's fun.
He's so fast that he's like – so they have this – you know the badges, right? The badges the players
have?
Yeah,
right.
He has a badge called Quick First Step.
Okay.
Oh, bro. He does one move, boom, he's gone.
Gone.
And I have a replay on my phone. He does a 360 layup. I'm like, okay, let's do this.
All right.
But, yeah, I played a couple games with him.
Jaren?
Jaren's really good. They updated his ball handling.
Who's the starting lineup for the Grizzlies on the game?
Ja, Dylan.
Dylan Brooks.
Kyle Anderson, Jaren, and JV.
Huh.
But the problem is 2K doesn't take into account that we're not going to have Iguodala. So Iguodala is the first man off the bench. So Brandon Clark does not play unless you put him in the game.
Huh.
Yeah.
Do they have the guy that we signed from Serbia on there?
No. Not that I saw.
Marko Gudurić?
No, he wasn't on there. But I will say one new feature 2K added that I love, that is just me because I'm a style person. So you know when you pick your uniforms?
Yeah.
So in 2K, when you go into the uniform thing, you can pick the accessory colors now. So if you want to pick your headband color, the sleeve color, like the compression short color, like in the game, like before you go to the game, you can do that now.
Devin spent 3 hours
my God,
putting
yeah,
accessories on yeah, all the
and
players.
There's no
and then,
doubt
and
about
then play
that.
One, and then play one
Hell
game.
Yeah. And I'm the guy playing. If I played against, I'd be like, dude, just put the damn regular uniform on. Like, just play the game.
So the uniforms are on there. The new court's on there, which looks fantastic. And the last thing, the WNBA is on there, which, you know, I'm a big WNBA fan.
Yep.
I had to play one game with my team. It's fun, man. It's a fun game.
Yeah.
It's
do the female players, is it exactly the same? Yeah, they look identical.
They look identical, but they look identical. I was gonna say they can't dunk, but you know they can't dunk.
Brittany Griner can.
Brittany Griner.
I should have played with her last night.
Yeah, she
dunk. Hey, does Brittany Griner also have like a fight mode on there? Every time I see highlight clips of her on the internet, she's always trying to fight someone in a game.
She's angry.
But yeah, so it's a fun game, man. You'll enjoy it.
All right. We'll
enjoy it for sure.
So, anyways, we got a huge college football weekend that is coming up. Which the two biggest games for sure are going to be Texas A&M and Clemson and Texas and LSU. And we're going to talk about those games and everything else with Brian Edwards a little bit later. And then we will touch on the NFL week. Vinnie Verno is going to join us. Brian Edwards is going to join us. But when we come back, the band Camino has they've made an appearance on the Heat Seekers chart today on Billboard. And it just so happens they are playing a show at Minglewood Hall that is sold out tonight. Before they get to that, they're going to join us in studio on the other side. Chris Vernon Show.
Join up Grizz Nation. Pick up the best seats at the best prices to see your Grizz face the Lakers, Warriors, and more with Grizzlies 2019-20 season tickets. MVP season ticket members get exclusive access to events, seat upgrades, discounts on gear, and more. Tickets start at $9 per game. Call 901-888-HOOP or click grizzlies.com to purchase your seats today.
The Live Love Memphis Group can be found at livelovememphishomes.com. They are the best real estate agents in Memphis. Jennifer Karstensen and her team, they sold over 165 houses in 2016. They're going to sell more than that this year. If you know you need to sell a house soon, if you've been trying to sell a house for a long time, if you've had a sign in your yard way too long, or you know in the future you're going to need to because you're going to have to be moving, or you maybe even have to move out of town, get with Jennifer and her team and let them sell your house, because they sell these houses for the most money possible the quickest. And that's what you want from a real estate agent. They sell for the most money possible in the quickest amount of time. A home in Bartlett was on the market for just 4 hours, closed in 30 days. And here's the deal. Through their proven marketing systems, they may already have your buyer. You can contact them for a list of families actively looking for properties who haven't been able to find a match. Find them online, livelovememphishomes.com. Livelovememphishomes.com.
Growling over your car insurance, Grizz fans? Here's something to really wave your growl towel about. Direct Auto and Life Insurance can get you the coverage you need, the services you want, and the respect you deserve, regardless of your driving history. Direct makes it easy for you to manage your insurance and get a free quote whenever you want. Score big savings with their flexible payment options, low rates, and discounts. To learn more about all of their pleasant surprises, Call 1-877-GO-DIRECT. Click or come into any of their local stores.
In today's healthcare environment, it's important to be your own champion. If you've suffered an injury or have aches and pains, physical therapy can make all the difference. Choose Select Physical Therapy to get back in the game as the official athletic training and physical therapy service provider for your Memphis Hustle. Select's clinical team provides the best care. Request an appointment today at selectphysicaltherapy.com. Select has more than 20 convenient locations in Tennessee. The Hustle choose Select Physical Therapy. So can you. Select Physical Therapy, the power of physical therapy.
Seven-time Grammy winner Carrie Underwood is bringing her the Cry Pretty Tour 360 to FedEx Forum on October 23rd. Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com, by phone at 800-745-3000, or at the FedEx Forum box office. Carrie Underwood's the Cry Pretty Tour 360, October 23rd at FedEx Forum.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Brought to you by Direct Auto Insurance. Live from the American Home Shield Studio inside FedEx Forum. Be sure with the shield and go to AHS.com today for your free no-obligation home warranty quote. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
Well, Reverend, Reverend, please come quick. 'Cause I got something to admit. I met a man out in the sticks, a good old miss. He drove a series tank Cadillac and wore a cigar on his lip. Don't you know the devil wears a suit and tie? Saw him driving down the 61 in early July, white as a cotton, feeling sharp as a knife. I heard him howling as he passed me by.
All right, we're back. Chris Vernon Show. And tonight over at Minglewood Hall, the band Camino is going to be playing. And if you check out Billboard today, they are on the Heatseekers chart at number 20 with their new album. And Spencer Stewart and Graham Rowell from Memphis itself.
Yes, sir.
And the band Camino are here in studio. All right. Both went to Briarcrest.
Mm-hmm. Yep, go Saints.
How did this
Todd Roll, Christian Brothers.
How did this band come together? When did you guys start playing together?
So, we went to the same school. So
right.
I knew him since I was like 14, and we both did music. And then Jeff went to Germantown.
Okay.
He's the other singer in the band. And he had like a country project, and I was playing bass for that. And then it kind of evolved into like a more Americana thing. And then we had one rehearsal at Briarcrest. We rehearsed at the Briarcrest band room for like first year.
Years.
And until the principal kicked us out. Like, not even kidding. Shout out Eric Sullivan.
Call him out, man.
It was like this Americana thing. And then one day, like after rehearsal, we like started jamming on what became our first song, Young. And we were like, this is not Americana, but like maybe we should do something with it. And we kind of just went down the road of like, instead of being like the Jeffrey Jordan band, we're like, let's make this like a band. And
what grade are you guys in then?
I was in college.
That's why I kicked you out of the.
Yeah. We weren't supposed to be there.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Our drummer at the time was the band director, so he was letting us use the. So it was nice.
Yeah, we would be there after hours, and it was.
So you were in college. You guys were still in school?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I was about to drop out. I dropped out of Memphis like halfway through sophomore year, but it was around that time.
Okay, so when's the first show? When do you guys play your first show as a band?
Ooh, our first show was down, I think, was it at Otherlands? Or was it at,
I think it was at Lafayette's, actually.
Oh, yeah, it was.
We played like four songs for like 20 people.
No. It was the Mid-South Fair.
Yes.
We played the Mid-South Fair.
Mid-South Fair.
About four people. Oh, no, it's probably about eight people, and four of them were my family.
Yeah, and then my girlfriend.
And then, yeah, his girlfriend.
So maybe two people.
Yeah, maybe. But we did get some fire-ass Pronto Pups.
At that point, are you still in high school, or are you out
of
high school?
No,
college.
No. So we're all in college at this point.
Okay, so is everybody going to go off to college, or are you guys, like, by the time you get out of high school, like, hey, we need to do this, like, for a living. We need to try to put a band together.
I wanted to do music ever since high school, and it's funny, like, we all intended on kind of doing other stuff. Like, my dream was, like, I wanted to play bass for, like, a Katy Perry or, like, a Justin Bieber and just be, like, a hired gun guy. And so I was doing that for a lot of people in college just to get a gig.
And I was going to be a music educator. Yeah. I was going to go teach choir like a nerd.
Yeah, and so then we, like, kind of, like, it didn't fall in our laps, but, like, the way that we made it in music or wanted to make a career wasn't how we intended, but it ended up being pretty great.
Okay, so how did you?
Well,
did you go to college?
Yeah, I went to college. I went to Southern Mississippi for 3 semesters, and then I took a semester off to work, and then I went back up to Memphis, and I dropped out after that. So. Yeah. Spent a lot of money for no particular reason.
At what point does the band become like something you guys think you're going to be doing for a job?
2015.
Yeah, 2015.
Yeah, we
it was 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We just decided this is what we wanted to do, and we made it a priority, and we just decided that we were going to book a bunch of shows and see if it responds in any way, if it grows naturally in any way, like, we'll stick with it.
Okay, so how do you come up with the name? And what other names did you play under? I want to hear all of them.
Very, very bad.
Yes.
So we had that demo, that song, Young, and we were like, we just need to release this because, like, we had that first show coming up, and we were like, we need at least something on, like, SoundCloud. So we were, like, had a group text with all these really bad names, and we were just, like, sending stuff. Like, what was one?
I'm trying to think. There was one. It was like Jeffrey's grandfather's, like,
he had a cotton
grain,
gin.
Very like a cotton business.
He was like R&H Gin Co.
I was like, that's like not gonna work. I don't think.
And then there was another one that I suggested that was probably really bad, but I saw an El Camino. I remember exactly where I was. I was by the East Memphis Target, and like El Camino pulled out, and I was like, Camino, and everyone was like, I don't know, and I was like, look, we got to do something, and I think Camino would look cool on a shirt. And any
he basically just told us to pick a name.
Well, no, I was like, any band name is weird until you either say it enough or they make it like big, and then it's like, oh, whatever, sure. So then we're like, whatever, we'll stick with Camino, sure. And then all like Camino social handles were taken because it's a Spanish word and like the car and just everything. So it had to be the band Camino, and then people just started calling us the band Camino. And then it kind of stuck. And
so you were going to name yourselves Camino.
Yeah. Well, there's actually a Japanese band called Camino.
Yeah.
And they have like...
They soundtrack like anime movies and stuff. Yeah. So we
pretty cool.
Like,
we couldn't take that name. So
yeah. It just became the band Camino. And it, in a cool way, Camino means path. So it's like we chose like the band path.
Okay.
So like that's like...
Some nice Spanglish.
Stop trying to make it more than it is. We saw an El Camino.
That's really badass. Yeah. We named it up.
You ain't got to be deep with me. Yeah. All right.
Yeah. Thank you.
You saw an El Camino at Target, for God's sake.
It looks good on a shirt.
Did you play under any other names?
Just the Jeffrey Jordan band, but not... We never...
And then you guys are like, enough with you.
Yeah.
Enough with you. We're part of this too, okay?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, we were like, we're going to make it a band. But no, we...
Did he fight it? Did he say no? I like
no.
The
it was
name.
No. Yeah, he loved it.
It was actually like all the idea. Yeah. It was all a mutual decision, which is happened organically.
It was whenever we play bar gigs, we'll like pick a name because we don't want to go under our name just for.
Oh, I have a good different story different. About that.
Yeah. What was it? Was
I got
the Good Time Party Gals. That's what we called ourselves.
The Good Time Party Gals.
Yeah. We also did a gig in Ole Miss with our friend of house guys from Memphis too, Drew Irwin. He went to Arlington.
He's a Bears fan.
He's like a football star. Yeah, he's our Bears fan.
Shout out to him.
Sorry, Drew. But so I got robbed and I had a Ford Escape and they took my car. So the band name for that gig was the Ford Escaped.
Ford Escaped. Yeah. Yeah. There you go. All right. So now you're playing at shows. You talk about playing at the Mid-South Fair and then you guys played at Lafayette. You played at Otherlands. So you start playing around town. Hmm. When is the first time you guys booked something out of town?
Was it in Arkansas? Was it?
I think
it
was Arkansas.
It was either Little Rock or
it was the Rock. It was.
Like, is this happening? Is this happening fast? Are you guys all doing jobs and then doing these gigs at night? And then, like, at some point it becomes like, hey, like, we can do this a lot. We need to play a lot of shows.
It started, like, weekends, I think.
Okay. Yeah, it was mostly weekend stuff.
Where are you working?
Spencer? I was working at Briarcrest as, like, a tech assistant. Like, I was, like, doing... They built, like, a super nice, like, theater, like, right after I left, of course. Like,
gotcha.
So, yeah.
So you're working
there. So I was working there, and I was also working at Urban Outfitters, like a total millennial.
And where are you?
I have very supportive parents, so I had dropped out at this point, and I was just, like, trying to grind in music. So I was, like, interning at studios around town. I worked at Ardent for a little bit.
You worked at Martin
Guitar. Worked at Martin Music.
Yeah.
Basically anywhere I could like meet people and just
make the connection.
Yeah, and also when they would let me like take off to do music stuff. So anything that would do that, that's kind of what I was doing. And Jeff was still in school. Jeff is the only one that graduated.
Which means he's incredibly, like, a lot smarter than
us. He stuck with it. And then Andrew was also in school, our first drummer. But yeah, we were just doing like weekends and stuff. I think the first one was like, was it Sticky's Rock and Roll?
I think it was Sticky's Chicken Shack in Little Rock, which has since closed.
Yeah.
Where do you first go out of town and somebody knows one of your songs?
That's a good question. It might have been there. I think we might have had like two fans that would sing the words to Young because it was on SoundCloud, and that was like the only reason.
Is that how people found you? SoundCloud?
Honestly, initially. Spotify.
Spotify
was big for us because there's a feature on Spotify called like, is it the Discover Radio?
Or yep.
Like
the Discover. Yeah.
So and Discover Weekly too. So basically, we got kind of swept in the algorithm of like a lot of other alt bands, and so that's how people found us. It was really Spotify and also us just playing like, dude, we played so many shows for like 12 people in places. Like I think the first tour we did was like, was it the Raleigh one with like 11 people?
Yeah, there were 11 people at like a 400.
We did like
room.
An East Coast thing.
Like, it was very sad.
But when I say East Coast, it was like we only had like three shows booked because like no one would really take us. But we played in Raleigh and there's like 11 people, but they knew the words. And then we played Rockwood Music Hall in New York. That was like the first one where I was like, whoa, we're in a big city. People like.
Are aware of us.
Yeah. Actually, yeah. But they were like literally like five people, but they were still there.
Hey, and they were aware of
you. They were aware.
So
they cared.
You were in New York and they knew who you were.
And if
were.
You give those people a good show, they'll bring two friends. And like,
yeah, and those people still come to shows and they're friends now. Yeah. So like it's really cool to see
that. Gotcha. So at what point is it a Spotify thing? Are you aware that this is getting bigger and that people are hearing your music?
We were aware that it was growing. And then I think the moment where it really popped off was the My Thoughts on You.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a song called My Thoughts on You. And we released it off of our Heaven EP in 2015 or 16?
16.
And it was like doing well. And it was getting streams. I think maybe at that point we had like one song with over a million streams. And we started noticing like songs would like pop up on like a viral chart and like go to like 15 and then like stop and then like little things. And then like the monthly listeners like steadily was growing. But then in December of 2016, maybe
something like that,
there was a playlist called The Ones That You Missed. And it was like songs that Spotify thinks you didn't get a chance to hear, but you would love. And it went out to everyone that had Spotify. It was like, here's your end of the year thing. Mm. And it wasn't like,
oh, wow.
Like, so you had no choice.
And did you guys have anything to do with it? Did you have like a marketing agency or nobody
just,
behind you?
Nope. Yeah, we had absolutely no idea.
Somebody at Spotify just is a fan.
Showed us a little love, yeah.
And that was really the moment where, like, real. I think My Thoughts on You was the one that had a million streams, like, by the fall. Mm-hmm. And then after that popped off, it got like 2 million in like a month. And we were like, whoa.
Yeah,
something happened.
Something happened.
And then after that, it was like consistent like monthly listener growth as we.
Okay, so how does it go from the tours and like you going and like some people may know your music, some people not, to like you guys just played Lollapalooza, right? Like a couple months ago.
I mean, it's insane. We, it's just a lot of growth, but like also a lot of like hard work that's been put in before. We moved to Nashville about a year ago, which
did it jump from like, you know, a couple hundred people maybe to next thing you know, you're playing in front of thousands of people.
It really didn't. It was really more consistent. Yeah, it was very, very incremental.
We never had a moment of like,
holy shit, there's
like 1,000 people.
Yeah,
it was
we didn't
just
have
like
a big song that like took us from 100 to 1,000. It's like
it was very incremental.
Every single number.
So when I listen to the new album, who's the guy that got his heart ripped out?
Jeffrey.
That'd be Jeff.
That would
be Jeffrey.
This guy. I mean, he's seeing the girl in the hallway. The ghost. I mean, I'm listening to this album. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
Man. It'd be so funny if you met.
Like, are you okay?
Dude, if you met this guy, it would be so funny because he's not like that
he's
at
so
all
bubbly.
Person. He's like the bounciest. Like he's got this big curly hair and like he's.
Does she know these songs are about her?
I don't even. I have no idea.
I don't even know.
Probably not.
Probably not.
There might be a couple muses.
Yeah.
We need to.
There might be a couple. Yeah.
Those are about different women. Oh, yeah. I didn't.
Potentially. I don't want to speak for Jeff.
Yeah, I can't. I can't.
I do know him intimately. So.
All right, so the different songs. And the other thing is, my favorite one is Honest. I like that because, you know what, we were just playing that cover on Wednesday of Higher Love by Whitney Houston. There's a new cover, right, that just came out. And like that old Steve Winwood, Peter Gabriel, like you guys have like synthesizer. You got all that, like that 80s stuff
definitely
that's going on in that song, which you just don't hear anymore.
Yeah, well, I think that, well, first off, Spencer and our drummer Garrison wrote that with some friends, so he can talk more about that one. But as far as like the 80s thing, like it's really cool because people do the 80s thing, but I think that we tried to lean into it instead, and we're like, hey, this is going to sound like freaking Miami Vice.
Yeah, it was like intentionally a very, like Phil Collins, like like Genesis type
and
kind
you know,
of like
and you know that's
feel
how,
good type thing.
That band, the 1975,
right?
Yeah. When you put it on now, or Francis and the Light, they kind of, they're kind of doing it like, it's almost like this throwback to stuff that people really like.
Yeah,
like
dude.
Pop music. Yeah.
It's the nostalgia. We're like in the middle of this big nostalgic phase. Like everybody wants to just hear what they heard back in like, and it's about to be the 90s. Like it's about to, we're about to go full like
grunge.
Literally. Like everyone's about to do grunge.
And like
Nirvana
Bruno Mars
type stuff.
Has like the 90s R&B drums and stuff. Like.
Right.
Exactly.
So figuring out what you guys, so you wrote that song, figuring out what you guys wanted it to sound like, and you say it's intentionally 80s at the time.
Definitely.
Are you, at this point, because now you signed with Elektra, things are getting bigger and bigger. You're selling out places like Birmingham, Nashville. You sold out Memphis tonight. When you try to figure out, like, okay, here's what we are. This is what we want people to be able to count on. Our sound is. Or are you like, let's try everything, and we'll do a song that's like this, and a song that's like this, and a song that sounds like the 80s?
We like to be open about it. We're still looking exactly for the right words to describe our sound. We like to like let other people decide, and we're just going to write the songs and let them be how they're going to be. Like they're good reflections of how we feel at the time, and we listen to like such different, like a wide variety of music. And I feel like a lot of people that are our age do that same thing, especially because of Spotify. It's like really easy.
It's very much like a generational thing that you can listen to a playlist that'll have like a country song, and then like a super hard rap song, and like a metal song, and that's like not weird now.
Yeah, it's like totally
so we weird. Always said, and like ever since the beginning, our band is like gonna be a spectrum of us, or sorry, of genres, because like that's what we grew up. Like I grew up on like soul, he grew up on like R&B stuff, and then Jeff like has a country background. So like we all have interests, and
so we don't want to box ourselves.
Is that what's going on in the tour bus? You're listening to, like, whose music dominates?
A lot of the time, our manager Jameson's does. So we listen to a lot of Slipknot.
Yeah, I love Slipknot. Yeah, they're like one of my favorite bands.
You guys listen to heavy metal?
Yeah.
It's a nice.
Honestly, you make the most playlists.
Yeah, I make a lot of the playlists.
Yeah.
So but what do you listen to now?
I just listen to a lot of like newer indie stuff, and I also listen to like, but then I also listen to like Usher, Confessions, and all that type of stuff. Just, I mean, anything. I really like it. Like it all. It's all about like how it makes you feel, how you want to feel when you're listening to a song. And like,
do you like country music?
I did not for the longest time because I just didn't understand it. But Jeffrey's like kind of changed my mind.
I've always liked country, and moving to Nashville has been cool because it's like, I've always liked country, like Sturgill Simpson and like Jason Isbell kind of country. Yeah. And we've met a lot of friends that are pop country artists, and like they've become our friends and they're country writers. And I was never into that, and not from like a pretentious standpoint. I just like didn't listen to country radio because like I went to Briarcrest and everyone had a truck.
Yeah, everyone.
So I was like, I don't want to do that. But now like knowing these people and like supporting them as friends, it's made me like listen to it with like fresh ears. And instead of being like, oh, the song's about a truck, it's like, oh, well, like, that clearly relates to like a lot of people, so like that is valid. As long as someone relates to a song, that makes
it
valid.
Yeah, there's so much value.
Did you guys move to Nashville because of the music industry or because you love traffic?
It is so bad.
It is awful.
Dude,
we did move for the music industry, but it's insane.
Had a baby, and it took us an hour to go 2 miles, and I'm like, how?
So we had
how can you live like this? I can't take it. I could have walked.
Yeah,
I could have walked.
We had bus call, and our like I live like south of the city, and the bus was like north. So we had to drive our cars, park at the lot, get on the bus. And before I got in the shower, I checked. It was like 30 minutes, and I was like, whatever, that sucks. But for Nashville, that's not that bad. Get out of the shower.
It's 7 a.m.
Yeah, it's 7 a.m. I get out of the shower, Look at my phone again, and it says an hour and 10. And I was in the shower like 6 minutes.
Oh, no. So
that's Nashville.
And it took every single second of that hour forever. 10.
All right, who are the big sports fans in the band?
Us.
You yeah, guys.
That's why.
That's why, yeah.
And so what do you guys care about the most?
Memphis Grizzlies basketball, yeah. Dude.
Both.
Yeah.
You're both huge Grizzlies fans.
Huge Grizzlies fans, huge Tigers fans. My girlfriend was a Tigerette baton twirler.
There you go.
At U of M, so huge Tigers fans. But, yeah, Grizzlies, ride or die. I will defend all the Grizzlies with my life.
Is that because, I guess you guys grew up in the perfect range,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like your age group, you guys are kids when
Tony, they were playing in the pyramid.
Sebo,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
My,
all them going.
My favorite basketball memory is the Spurs playoff game where Sebo hit the three.
Yep.
And everyone was like chanting Sebo out there. But my first sports memory ever was my dad taking me. We were so bad. It was when Steve Nash was on the Suns, like right before he went to the Lakers, and they killed us. It was like 130-80, and we were like and we had like nosebleeds.
It's probably
like
one of those 20-win years. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, we had nosebleeds, and my dad was like, "You want to go courtside?" I was like, "Can we do that?" He's like, "Son, no one's here."
No one.
And so, you walked straight down.
But
the
yeah,
court.
And like because of that, I was like, "This is cool though. Like I like it." And so I just like we would keep going and like. Like for Christmas, I would ask my parents, like, you could do like the Christmas package of like 10 games. So, like, me and a buddy in high school would like pick 10 games, and like my parents would like give me that for Christmas, and like we would go. But yeah, I mean, just like watching it, like,
same get with you, better. Spencer.
Yeah, my whole family is.
I know your older
huge.
Brother.
Yeah,
he has always been a huge fan.
Our parents' house still, the Wi-Fi password is like the 2014 starting lineup. It's like Mike Conley. There's like MCTA.
That's awesome.
Tayshaun Prince.
Yeah.
Like it was all that stuff. So it was.
It's a little harder when you guys are on the road keeping up with everything, right?
It is. We got leaked pass, so we're good to go.
Ah.
So we're good. And our photographer is our resident Lakers fan, so.
Yeah.
So you guys now, once you got a bus with league pass on it, you're set,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Now
that's
we're
all I'm
going to
be doing.
I don't even know if we're going to play the show. We're just going to like, we're just going to watch the game.
So what's now? How many shows you got? I guess you guys are in the middle of a tour, right?
Yeah, we literally just started
this
Wednesday.
Show three.
This is show three tonight.
Of how many?
32, I think.
Yeah. All over?
Like all over.
All over.
All over. So we'll go, after this, we'll head over to, we're playing Moon River Festival in Chattanooga.
Yep.
And then we go up to New York, and then we'll go do some East Coast shows, go through the Midwest, and then go down West Coast, and then go play through
Has there been anybody that you have been intensely shocked, knew of you, or had heard one or liked one of your songs or reached out to you because of it?
Taylor Swift put one of our songs on one of her playlists, we've like kind of freaked out just a little bit about that. That was,
yes.
She's only like the biggest star in the whole world right now. So
Lindsay Lohan slid in our DMs.
That was pretty cool.
Hold on now.
We
want to know about that.
She
just
said hi.
She said hi. That's it.
That's literally
it. We were in like Kansas City. And we're at dinner, and all of us got a notification. And I was like, because we all have like the band account on the phones. And I was like, I thought this was like a spam.
Yeah, it had. We were like,
and I clicked on it, and it was like verified. It just said hi.
It just.
And then I replied. I was like, "Sup, Lindsay?" No reply ever. No context for that.
Wait, that was a response. What's up, Lindsay?
Yeah.
Lindsay?
I mean, like.
No, if you sent her like a Mean Girls
gift
or something,
Lindsay Lohan?
Like, you say you up.
Yeah.
You up?
You up?
So,
she is, by the way.
Yeah.
She is up.
Yeah. She was always
she's
up.
She's always up.
Yeah, but she never, ever replied, so no context for that whatsoever.
That was, yeah, that
but that was pretty
thing.
Weird. Brandi Cyrus was at the show last night.
Nice.
Miley's cool sister.
Have you met Taylor Swift?
No.
Well,
we never talked to her or anything.
No.
But.
Never figured out how she heard the song. I guess just apparently she listens to Spotify like avidly and just loves music.
And she put you on her playlist.
Yeah, it was called like Songs Taylor Loves, and it was just like a playlist. And we were like right down towards the bottom, Berenstain, one of her songs.
And you guys have absolutely no idea how that happened.
Nope.
I think she just found it.
She just found it and
liked it.
Just liked the song. So
that's the best thing that could possibly
literally the best thing
that could possibly happen. All right, so tonight, Minglewood Hall, I would tell people to go get tickets, but you sold the place out.
Yeah.
Which has got to make you feel awesome in your hometown,
it's
right?
It's crazy. We grew up going to shows there.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like,
we've played 1884 there like so many times.
So many times.
It's cool to finally like break the barrier and do the big room.
Step
and especially sell it out.
Do you remember the best one you've seen there? I've seen a lot of shows there,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, dude. Lord Huron was really good when they came.
Yeah.
Who else?
I saw Walk the Moon there when Shut Up and Dance came out. So like, they were really popping off, and that was really good.
I tell you this, it is not easy to sell it out.
Dude, no.
It's not.
It's a big room. It's like cavernous.
Yes.
It just goes.
And we sell a lot of tickets in there, too, because they keep squeezing them in.
No doubt. We also went and saw some of those. We saw an MMA fight there. Our buddy's an MMA fighter, and those were really fun. The V3 fights.
Yeah.
It's the most intense sporting event.
No, it's the best. And that's Nick Harmeyer's group that puts those together. They got jumbotrons and everything.
It's super legit. They do it. They do it.
It's like
real.
Crazy. He was saying our friend Logan Reed is a fighter. Yeah. And when you know someone that's like in the ring, it is the weirdest feeling because you're like,
primal, man.
You're like, oh my god, like my friend's about to kill this guy or get killed.
So there's a bunch of kids like from Briarcrest and from around town that like now want to be your friends now.
I guess
people reach out. People reach out. They're like, hey, we're buddies tonight.
Yeah.
There's definitely.
There's a lot of like, oh, dude, I didn't get a ticket. Is the guest list like open? And I'm like, hey, man, like you called me fat in high school. The guest list is not open. So yeah, there's a lot of that, but there's also a lot of support too.
The guest list is not open. Yeah. No,
it's not.
Good luck to you guys, man.
Thanks
for coming in. I dig the album, and
thank you, man.
This has all been great to watch you guys rising up over the course of the last, you know, 6 months to last year. This has been
crazy.
This has blown up for you. Because Jordan, your brother, I remember years ago, he was like, hey, my brother's band's playing at the New Daisy after the Grizzlies game. Yeah. If you can get over there. And the next thing I know, it's like I see him tweeting out, you know, Billboard charts and stuff.
Yeah. Well, it's crazy.
Hold
like
on now.
I just like check Twitter. And I'm like, I saw that yesterday before soundcheck. I was like, guys, we're on that Billboard Heat Seekers chart. That's sick. So.
Super awesome.
It's crazy, man.
Well, good luck with the show tonight, guys.
Thank you so much for the support.
The band Camino. We'll be back after this. Brian Edwards from VegasInsider.com is going to join us, get us ready for the college football weekend. Chris Vernon, show.
Chris Stapleton's All-American Roadshow. Saturday, October 5th, FedEx Forum, with special guests. No, Brothers Osborne. No, and Kendall Marvel. Down and lonesome, but I feel Chris Stapleton. Tickets on sale now at livenation.com.
In today's healthcare environment, it's important to be your own champion. If you've suffered an injury or have aches and pains, physical therapy can make all the difference. Choose Select Physical Therapy to get back in the game as the official athletic training and physical therapy service provider for your Memphis Hustle. Select's clinical team provides the best care. Request an appointment today at selectphysicaltherapy.com. Select has more than 20 convenient locations in Tennessee. The Hustle choose Select Physical Therapy. So can you. Select Physical Therapy, the power of physical therapy.
Tight games and expensive car insurance are nerve-wracking. Say boo to these nerves and let our friends at Direct Auto and Life Insurance put your mind at ease. Finally, car insurance worth waving your growl towels for. Direct Auto makes car insurance affordable for everyone by offering flexible payment options, low rates, and discounts regardless of your driving history. Save more on car insurance with Direct Auto, finding a great rate and great services. Now, that's a pleasant surprise. Call 1-877-GO-DIRECT. Click or come in for Direct Auto's flexible payment options, low rates, and discounts.
The Live Love Memphis Group can be found at livelovememphishomes.com. They are the best real estate agents in Memphis. Jennifer Carstensen and her team, they sold over 165 houses in 2016. They're going to sell more than that this year. If you know you need to sell a house soon, if you've been trying to sell a house for a long time, if you've had a sign in your yard way too long, or you know in the future you're going to need to because you're going to have to be moving or you maybe even have to move out of town, get with Jennifer and her team and let them sell your house because they sell these houses for the most money possible, the quickest. And that's what you want from a real estate agent. They sell for the most money possible in the quickest amount of time. A home in Bartlett was on the market for just 4 hours, closed in 30 days. And here's the deal. Through their proven marketing systems, they may already have your buyer. You can contact them for a list of families actively looking for properties who haven't been able to find a match. Find them online. LiveLoveMemphisHomes.com. LiveLoveMemphisHomes.com.
Heart, Love, Alive Tour.
Ooh,
Barracuda.
And Joan Jett of the Blackhearts.
I don't give a damn about my reputation.
Ann and Nancy Wilson. Heart. Joan Jett of the Blackhearts. Friday, October 4th, FedEx Forum. Hart and Joan Jett of the Blackhearts together. Reserve seats on sale now at LiveNation.com.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Brought to you by Direct Auto Insurance. Live from the American Home Shield Studio inside FedEx Forum. Be sure with the shield and go to AHS.com today for your free no-obligation home warranty quote. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
Congrats to the Band Camino on all their big success, and they're going to play that sold-out show tonight at Minglewood. How cool to see them on the Billboard charts today. How cool. It just happens to be today is the day Memphians, that they are there. Memphians, real Memphians, yeah. And real Grizzly fans,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
And they are blowing up, so good for them. They've signed with Elektra Records, and things are going really well. Brian Edwards from VegasInsider.com. He is a senior handicapper for that site. He joins us weekly, and he joins us now. Brian!
Berno, what's happening?
Hey, buddy. All right, we got games to get to. There was nothing last night unless, there was stupid Mitch Trubisky. But no college games last night. But there is a slate that is going on tonight. What do you like tonight? Do we have anything that we can build up the war chest, as they say, for Saturday?
Well, I don't want to sound too bullish on it because I got a good number early in the week. I got Boise State minus 10.5. That's not available now. It's only at 12. But, I still lean that way, but, I'd hate for it to be a 38-27, 35-24 game and it not work out for your listeners. But how about Hank Bachmeier last week, true freshman quarterback, the highest-rated recruit in Boise State history, out of California, throws for 407 yards at FSU, and they rally from deficits of 24-6 and 31-13. They doubled them up, time of possession, 40 minutes and 3 seconds to 19:57. They had a 621-426 advantage in total offense. And FSU players were cramping left to right, and Boise coming from the altitude into the brutal August heat of Florida and humidity, and they got stronger as the game went. Marshall is a very good group of five team, but this is a short week, and they had to fly all the way across the country. And under Doc Holliday of the last decade, Marshall is only 10-17-2 against the spread as a road underdog. I think Boise wins by 2 touchdowns. But again, I got it at minus 10.5, so at minus 12, I wouldn't risk a whole lot. If the total was at 57 at most books, I lean the over. I was able to get it at 56.5 and buy the half point to 56 early in the week for a smaller play than Boise. I think 56 is a key number with totals being a multiple of 7. But so Boise State and over is what I'm thinking tonight. I'm a pass on Wake Forest Rice. Rice, my first cousin's son plays for that team, so I watched a lot of the Rice Army game last week, and Rice played pretty feisty against Army. Only lost by 7, but I can't endorse the play on the Owls.
All right. So Boise in the over, but you got obviously better numbers. Maybe people can tease it down if they want to mess with it. If they're bored tonight. Speaking of that game, I almost bet against Florida State. I don't know who does Florida State have. I wanted to bet against them just because Willie Taggart said his team was dehydrated. I was like, come on, that's goofy.
Yeah, and why is Willie giving Gatorade free promotion? I mean, they use Powerade. That's not working in Florida in August.
Why?
FSU was like 22.5 at last look against the ULM Warhawks. Looks like they're 22 most spots.
Warhawks played was that Lafayette? Who played Mississippi State? Lafayette played Mississippi State. They played them pretty hard actually last weekend. All right, Boise tonight, if anything. All right, let's get to Saturday and the games that you like the most. What do we like on Saturday, Brian?
Okay, I mean, I'm sure you remember me playing this MAC team a lot in the last year or two, Verno, and that is Eastern Michigan. They're plus 15.5 at Kentucky. Their last 6 games as double-digit underdogs, they're 6-0 against the spread. In their last 16 as road underdogs, they're 14-2 against the spread, including a 24-20 loss at Kentucky 2 years ago as a 14.5-point underdog. Their quarterback, Mike Glass, last week, 20 of 22, 188 yards, 3 touchdowns without an interception. He was a JUCO transfer, but he started 3 games last year and had a 9-1 TD INT ratio with 6 rushing touchdowns. He added another rushing touchdown last week. They covered at Coastal Carolina. So this quarterback for his career, 12-1 TD INT ratio, and he can run also 7 rushing touchdowns. The injury report for Eastern Michigan is blank. It is 100% clean. Kentucky is 1-10 against the spread. Its last 11 is a home favorite. They ended a 10-game ATS losing streak and covered against Toledo last week in a 38-24 win as a 10-point favorite. But that game was tied at halftime. The Rockets were up 14-7. Kentucky got a defensive touchdown in the game. And one last factoid on Eastern Michigan, because the line is 15.5, this stat applies. The last time Eastern Michigan lost by 15 points, I'm sorry, last time they lost by more than 15 points, they haven't done it in 35 games in a row. Week 2 loss at Missouri in 2016. Since then, nobody's beaten them by more than 15.
All right, Eastern Michigan plus 15.5. What else we like on Saturday?
Big revenge game for Chris Peterson and Washington. They lost 12-10 in Berkeley to Cal last year when they were -2 in turnover margin. Jacob Eason had basically been on the sidelines for 2 years. I think he might have got some mop-up duty with Georgia and blowouts late in 2017. But his first significant snaps in 2 years, he was 27 of 36 for 349 yards, 4 touchdowns without an interception last week. So I'm going to lay 13.5 with Washington at home against Cal. Cal was down 10-0 to FCS opponent UC Davis at the end of the first quarter last week, and it was tied at 13 with less than 4 minutes left in the third. The Golden Bears eventually won 27-13 but failed to cover. I like Washington minus the 13.5.
Yeah, there's two of these games that people are using, last year's result as to talk about this year's. And so there's a lot of, you remember what happened when they played Cal last year, right? And it's like, well, hold on now. Like, Jacob Eason wasn't the quarterback there. And you know where I'm starting to get that feel also is the
–
the friggin' Clemson game. It's terrifying me. Because I absolutely think that Texas A&M at 17.5 is, like, that's – I would just take that sight unseen – But, bro, why is that line not going down? Like, something is – like, they're just going to – I feel like now I'm starting to worry that they're just going to – Clemson's just going to kill them. And, you know, that last year's result is irrelevant.
What,
and,
what did
and
that open up at?
It, like, same. It's like
– 19.
Yeah. Oh, I've got it.
17 and a half.
I've got a 16 and a half.
Sheesh. Sheesh.
Yeah, it's down to 16 and a half at some offshores. I thought the opener was 19, but most of the games of the year book this summer had it at 17 or 17 and a half.
Yeah, and it's, I guess, 16 and a half now. I mean, that's still, that feels super high for, that game was a great game last year. So how can we move forward a year and that be the line? But I'm with you on the Washington thing because it's like, okay, that's cool that California played them tough last year. Great. Like, that's not...
And remember, A&M had the controversial fumble down at the goal line that went just inside the pylon and was a touchback. I mean, they could have won that game for sure.
They could have won the game, and now they're sitting on, you know, over two touchdown underdogs. All right, Eastern Michigan, Washington. What else you really love tomorrow?
Okay, let's go over 77 and a half on Hawaii and Oregon State.
Over 70, 45. Over 77 and a half. Good grief.
I made it 85. So, you know, Oregon State loses 52-36 to Oklahoma State for 88 combined last week. Week zero, 45-38, Hawaii. So that was 83. But Khalil Tate was 1 yard short of the goal line on the last play. Oregon State allowed an average of 45.7 points per game last year. Their leading tackler from last year, Jalen Moore, did not play last week. He's questionable for this week. And I just, you know, Jake Luton, the quarterback for Oregon State, he had really good numbers last week. And, I mean, I know Oklahoma State's defense is not very good, but neither is Hawaii's. I just think both offenses move the ball, and I think it's a shootout. Let's go over 77 and a half.
All right, over 77 and a half. So we got Eastern Michigan, Washington, the Hawaii, Oregon State over. Anything else you really like?
Okay, I'm not going to say I really like it because the Vanderbilt beat writer just got back to me on Twitter, and the two starting offensive linemen for Vandy that did not play last week, he said his educated guess is they're not going to play again this week. But I'm still going to take over 55 on Vandy Purdue. We've got Rondale Moore, the most explosive player in the country for Purdue. We've got Keyshawn Vaughn for Vandy, one of the more explosive players in the country. Purdue loses 34-31 at Nevada last week. That's 65 combined. Vandy, you know, 30-6. So they had a low-scoring game, but they're not playing Georgia's defense this week. I think that Kalijah Lipscomb, Jared Pinkney, and Keyshawn Vaughn get going this week, even if they're without two linemen that got some experience against Georgia last week. So I like over 55 on Purdue Vandy. That's a noon East or 11 a.m. Central.
All right. So Purdue Vandy. All right. Purdue Vandy. Okay. And there was one more. Oh, we did not mention Texas LSU, and I saw – you were promoting the great Tom Herman yesterday.
Yeah, so it's 6.5 now. Herman, in four seasons as a head coach, he is 13-2 against the spread with 10 outright victories in 15 games as an underdog. When he's been a home underdog, he's 4-0 against the spread with 3 outright wins. And going back even before Herman got there, even with Charlie Strong, Texas is 5-0-1 against the spread. Their last six is a home underdog. With that said, I'm not in a hurry to be going against LSU right now. I'm real high on LSU this year. If it gets to 7, I got to lean Texas. I'm probably going to do Texas in my contest. I hadn't filled out all my picks yet. But kind of scares me to go against LSU. But all those ATS trends, you know, and Sam Ellinger's a heck of a quarterback and baby Megatron to throw it to. So I guess slight lean to Texas if it gets to 7, but not an aggressive play amount-wise.
All right. Why is Tennessee favored?
Good question. I mean, BYU got beat up pretty bad 30-12 by Utah last week. I don't know. Hey, Georgia State's a 7.5-point favorite at home against Furman, an FCS opponent.
I saw that.
In case you're wondering. Verno, can I give you some great stats on Jeff Tedford?
You know what I was just thinking? It's crazy you say that. I was just thinking I would love to hear great stats on Jeff Tedford.
Okay.
It was just running through my mind.
Since he got to Fresno, he's been an underdog 8 times, and he's 8-0 against the spread. And the last 4, they have won outright. And 2 of the games, they were dogs. They covered. They didn't win outright. Let's forgive him. It was his first year. Back-to-back weeks, he covered but lost at top-ranked Bama and at 6th-ranked Washington. They're +3 at home to Minnesota, who struggled to win against an FCS opponent, but it was a good FCS opponent last week. I lean Fresno there, and let me also share.
Wait, Jeff Tedford is an underdog king? What'd you say, 8-0?
8-0 since he got to Fresno, 4 outright wins in a row.
Ooh, all right, Jeff Tedford. What's the number on that?
So they're +3 at home to Minnesota. They lost 31-23 at USC last week. See, Fresno didn't bring back many players, but he loaded up on JUCO guys like Fresno always did with Pat Hill.
Mm-hmm.
And, they fought USC to the finish last week. I'm not sure if USC's worth a flip or not, though.
I don't know. I mean, they had JT until halftime. They had Daniels. You know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah. I know this. They covered. They covered because that was a late game, and so everybody bet USC. got murdered.
Yeah, so I lean Fresno there, and I might end up taking them. You want me to give you some Alabama saving stats when they're laying big numbers like this?
No, because they're going to win that game 62-0. I don't care what the numbers are.
Okay.
62
to nothing. I wasn't going to endorse New Mexico State.
62-0. That's the score. You know what Roser's doing tomorrow in Tunica? He's going to bet New Mexico State over 4.5, just so he's got the ticket.
I'm going to put $5 on New Mexico State to score over 4.5 points.
That's their team total?
Yeah. I told him it's a losing bet.
I'm like, just to have that ticket is the most absurd thing ever for a team to score more than 4 points.
New Mexico State is there. Yeah, team total 4.5. 4.5. That's the number.
Hey, Brian, because a lot of stuff I've listened to this week, it feels like everybody is on Cincinnati this week at Ohio State.
Oh. Is that right?
Yeah, and the line's gone down a little bit. And,
it's under 17 State, now.
Yeah, you know, I would love to have it at 17, but it looks like most books are 16 and some 15.5 now. And look, Ohio State has got a lot of injuries. 2 of their D tackles are out. Ronnie Hickman, the safety. I mean, I could read off. I'm looking at the injury list right now. It's like 8 guys are out. I would have to look up how many are starters. But Ohio State's banged up. And Cincy, do they have 2 extra days of prep? Do they play Friday or Thursday?
They play Thursday.
They play Thursday because that was the UCLA game.
2 extra days of preparation?
Yeah, but I don't like their coach talking crazy. He called them like the team up north or some crap, and he was like, he was doing the team up north stuff.
I like the over. If you got Ohio State defensive players missing, they'll give up points late in the game. But like, Ohio State's going to score points. They're too explosive not to score points. They're going to score points.
My DM to Verno, I said I leaned the over on that. It's only 53. That's a very low total for Ohio State games.
Cincinnati's defense is good though.
Yeah.
I thought they were good.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But they're at the shoe.
All right, last thing. There was some big underdog you sent me for the UFC.
Yeah, Dustin the Diamond Poirier, +350 against Khabib in the main event, UFC 242 in Abu Dhabi. I think he's got a good shot. He'll be the much better fighter when they're standing. And he's a big 155er that can defend takedowns from Khabib. I mean, look, Habib's never lost, so he's the guy that wrestles bears, remember? So, I'm not recommending a lot, but I think Dustin's worth a shot. The one I really like, the co-main event, Paul Felder, +135 against Edson Barboza, who has taken some ruthless beatings the last couple of years, including a first-round knockout from Justin Gaethje his last time out.
All right, what time is this thing going to be on? Because I can never keep up with the time changes.
I think it starts at 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock our time.
Right.
Are they doing it? Oh, is this an afternoon?
It's in it's in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, it's overseas.
It's in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, Abu Dhabi. Yeah, and you know what? I remember watching UFC 112, and it was an afternoon.
Okay, so the main event, I think, the main event is supposed to start at like 1:15 Central Time.
Oh,
so, Brian, you're East Coast, that's 2:15. The earliest fight is scheduled to start at 7:15 in the morning Central.
All right.
Well, you know, that's a good excuse for me to go to the sports bar just to start the day because, you know,
I got a free. Yeah, like you needed an excuse.
Get to the sports bar early. Let's watch some UFC.
You friggin' degenerate. Like you needed. Oh, now I need to go to the sports bar early.
I mean, I usually get there for the, like, CBS mid-afternoon game, but I need to be there for game day.
Yeah, you need to be there for game day and UFC 244 or whatever it is. Brian, have a great and profitable weekend. You've been very good so far with the picks. Eastern Michigan, Washington, the over in Hawaii, Oregon State, and the over in Purdue Vandy. That's what I have written down. Oh, and Tedford, Fresno.
Yeah, and I'm gonna go ahead and put Ohio State Cincy over in there also, per Roser's recommendation, and I've been thinking about it anyway.
Don't get talked into.
Why are you taking my recommendations?
Yeah, don't listen to that, loser.
Well, I was already thinking about it.
This guy's going to bet New Mexico State, and they're going to have zero.
check my DM to you on Twitter. I mentioned it.
All right. I'll check it. Enjoy your weekend, Brian. We'll talk to you next week.
Sounds great, fellas.
All right, buddy.
See y'all. Thanks.
Brian Edwards from VegasInsider.com joining us as he does on Fridays. You need to do Bama minus 55.5. That's the ticket you need. That's funnier to me. To me, that is funnier than New Mexico State, is the ticket that says minus. When will you ever get the chance to bet somebody minus 55.5?
I don't know. Who else does Alabama play this year?
Nobody that they're going to be favored by 55.5. That's an outrage. You know what I mean? For goodness sakes, New Mexico State's a Division I team. It's not like an FCS team.
Else does Alabama play? They play Western Carolina. They'll be favored by over 55 in that game.
Depends on what they do in this one.
That's true.
Right?
Who else does Clemson play? Clemson could be favored by that much.
I don't know, man. 55.5.
Oh, dude, Clemson plays Charlotte next week. Or no, in 2 weeks. They have Syracuse next week. They could be favored by that and get Charlotte.
What?
Clemson could be.
No.
Dude, it's Charlotte.
Okay, wait.
Don't you slander Charlotte.
Charlotte is 2-0 wait. 1-0 this season, Roser.
That's right. Congratulations.
Over Gardner Webb.
That's Tell right. me, beat Big so, Gardner Webb.
You don't go to Gardner Webb and get a win. Yeah,
big bad Gardner Webb.
All right, we got to take a break. Vinnie Verno is going to be on today. Vinnie Verno will be here when we get back. Let me remind you that the show is always brought to you by Direct Auto and Life Insurance. And if you want to save a ton of money on your auto and life insurance, give it direct. You can get a free quote today at directgeneral.com. Directgeneral.com. Also, you can call them. 1-877-GO-DIRECT, 1-877-GO-DIRECT, and you can save a bunch of money on your auto and life insurance, up to $565 a year, in fact. And then you could go bet on Vinnie Verno's games with that $565.
I just had a Tennessee fan text me and said, if the Vols continue to suck, Alabama might be 55.5 over them.
Come on. They're so down on
Tennessee
themselves.
Fans are just so down right now.
You know, I told you, my buddy sent me a he sent me a video. I need to put a music bed behind it. He sent me a video of him taking his license plate off his car.
Oh,
his
you
Tennessee,
need to definitely
his
put,
Tennessee
yeah,
license plate.
Yeah, you need to put some.
He took it off and then threw it.
You need to put like some Coldplay behind. Yeah. Put some Coldplay music under that.
It's like close to like burn. You know when people burn the jerseys?
Yes.
That's basically like that for college teams.
That's right. Taking the license plate off. Also want to remind you that if you need to sell a house in Memphis, if you know you're going to need to in the near future, if you've had a sign in your yard way too long, get with our girl Jennifer Carstensen. You know where she was this week? The U.S. Open in New York. She's a massive tennis fan. And she was at the U.S. Open this week. But her and her group of RE/MAX real estate experts are the absolute best real estate agents in town. They can help you out with whatever you need. Special link for our listeners, livelovegrizz.com, livelovegrizz.com. All right, boy, Vinnie Verno's up against the clock. Might not be a long one, but he told me he has winners, so we'll do them on the other side. Chris Vernon, show.
Join up Grizz Nation. Pick up the best seats at the best prices to see your Grizz face the Lakers, Warriors, and more with Grizzlies 2019-20 season tickets. MVP season ticket members get exclusive access to events, seat upgrades, discounts on gear, and more. Tickets start at $9 per game. Call 901-888-HOOP or click grizzlies.com to purchase your seats today.
The Live Love Memphis Group can be found at livelovememphishomes.com. They are the best real estate agents in Memphis. Jennifer Carstensen and her team, they sold over 165 houses in 2016. They're going to sell more than that this year. If you know you need to sell a house soon, if you've been trying to sell a house for a long time, if you've had a sign in your yard way too long, or you know in the future you're going to need to because you're going to have to be moving, or you maybe even have to move out of town, get with Jennifer and her team and let them sell your house, because they sell these houses for the most money possible the quickest. And that's what you want from a real estate agent. They sell for the most money possible in the quickest amount of time. A home in Bartlett was on the market for just 4 hours, closed in 30 days. And here's the deal. Through their proven marketing systems, they may already have your buyer. You can contact them for a list of families actively looking for properties who haven't been able to find a match. Find them online, livelovememphishomes.com. Livelovememphishomes.com.
Growling over your car insurance, Grizz fans? Here's something to really wave your growl towel about. Direct Auto and Life Insurance can get you the coverage you need, the services you want, and the respect you deserve, regardless of your driving history. Direct makes it easy for you to manage your insurance and get a free quote whenever you want. Score big savings with their flexible payment options, low rates, and discounts. To learn more about all of their pleasant surprises, call 1-877-GO-DIRECT. Click or come into any of their local stores.
In today's healthcare environment, it's important to be your own champion. If you've suffered an injury or have aches and pains, physical therapy can make all the difference. Choose Select Physical Therapy to get back in the game as the official athletic training and physical therapy service provider for your Memphis Hustle. Select's clinical team provides the best care. Request an appointment today at selectphysicaltherapy.com. Select has more than 20 convenient locations in Tennessee. The Hustle choose Select Physical Therapy. So can you. Select Physical Therapy, the power of physical therapy.
Seven-time Grammy winner Carrie Underwood is bringing her the Cry Pretty Tour 360 to FedEx Forum on October 23rd. Tickets are on sale now at Ticketmaster.com, by phone at 800-745-3000, or at the FedEx Forum box office. Carrie Underwood's the Cry Pretty Tour 360, October 23rd at FedEx Forum.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Brought to you by Direct Auto Insurance. Live from the American Home Shield Studio inside FedEx Forum. Be sure with the shield and go to AHS.com today for your free no-obligation home warranty quote. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
Tell me, why did you leave so fast? Tell me, why does it hurt so bad? Why you hit this bridge, you ain't so fast? I'll never leave you in the past. They kill my dog today, it's taking and they take my dog away. So I'm going hard today, cause for me it will be a call away. It's raining hard today, these serious drops, they keep falling, ayy. I gotta watch my enemies, cause I know that they be trying to get rid of me. They trying to steal all my energy, blind and scheming, they trample the enemy. Know some people around me right now, they ain't right, they be moving too finicky. You act like I owe you a something, little nigga, I'm starting to peel all your tendencies. But when I was down and when I was out, I couldn't call you, was you kidding me? Now in days, I don't even breathe too. Love my hood, but fuck it, I don't really need to. Cause they kill my bro, they killed a part of me too. Now it's a hole in my heart, everybody can see through.
Tell me, why did you leave so fast? Did you find it by yourself?
my music on. Turn my music on. Oh, another day, another dollar, another day, another dollar. I make picks, you make money. I make picks, you make money. Last week, another profitable weekend. I own week one. And now I own week two. If you are tired of not having money, if you are tired of reaching in your pocket and feeling lint, grab your pen and paper. Grab your pen and paper. I've got four locks, four bloodbaths, four massacres, four games you can bet your life on. Now, last week, we would have had an absolutely perfect slate if it weren't for that idiot from Northwestern who doesn't just dump on the damn ball. Other than that, a perfect slate. But this week I'm going 4-0, 4-0, 4-0. Last night after the games were over, last week after the games were over, I walked outside to my backyard. I put $1 million in the middle of the yard. I set it on fire and made $1 million s'mores. Yum, 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 yum. Let's go to the games. First game. Central Florida is a 10.5-point favorite over FIU, Florida Atlantic. Last week, Central Florida beat FAMU 62-0. Their starting quarterback had two touchdowns. Their backup quarterback had three touchdowns. Their third straight quarterback had a touchdown. And this week, they play against Florida Atlantic. And you say, Vinnie Verno, isn't that Lane Kiffin? Yep. Last week, Ohio State played against Florida Atlantic, and people were like, ooh, watch out for Florida Atlantic. Watch out for the Lane train. He sucks. The first quarter, you flip on the game. Ohio State scores every friggin' play. They ran a play, and then they scored. And then they ran another play, and they scored. And then they ran another play, and they scored. And then they ran another play, and they scored! And you say, well, Vinnie Verno, didn't Florida Atlantic score 21 points? Yeah, they scored 15 points in the fourth quarter after Ohio State went and grabbed fans out of the stands, put jerseys on them, and said, here, you go play against them. Kendall Briles left Florida Atlantic after 2017, the only time they were worth a crap. Last year, they suck. This year again, they suck. Florida Atlantic. Do you know how Florida Atlantic fan counts to 10? 0-1, 0-2, 0-3, 0-4. Central Florida's played 27 games over the last 3 years. 27. Do you know how many they have not won by double digits? Four. Four of 27 they have not won by double digits. And now they are going to play this rat team and not win by double digits? Central Florida deserves your respect. And let me remind you, Lane Kiffin is a dummy. And you say, Vinnie Verno, how dumb is Lane Kiffin? Lane Kiffin is so dumb that he went to the dentist to get a Bluetooth. Lane Kiffin is so dumb, he stuck his phone up his ass to make a booty call. Lane Kiffin is so dumb, he thought grape nuts was a venereal disease, and that he had it. Central Florida minus
10.5, but they win by not one, not two, not three, four touchdowns over FAU. It's my Lane Kiffin as a dummy game of the year. Next game, UCLA, you owe me. You owe me, UCLA. 8-point favorites over San Diego State. UCLA played like absolute crap against Cincinnati last week. And the QB played like he had mittens on, and they still had a chance if they didn't get screwed by the referees that had money on the game. The crooked refs had Cincinnati in that game, no doubt about it. This week, I am told that the referees will be on the up and up. Meanwhile, their opponent this week is San Diego State. San Diego State had a gigantic week one win. They won 6-0 over Weber State. 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 UCLA -8. It's my, they won 6-0 over Weber State. Game of the year. Next game. Texas is a 6.5-point underdog to LSU. Tom Herman is the underdog king. 15 games as an underdog as a head coach. He's 13-2. 10 outright wins. There are three things that are certain in life. Three rules to live by. One, never call your boss a cracker. Forgot about that one, Antonio Brown. Number two, never get a lap dance from a stripper with a bullet wound. And number three, never, never bet against Tom Herman as an underdog. Joe Burrow. They say, Vinnie Verno, what about Joe Burrow? I heard Joe Burrow's got a chance at the Heisman. I heard Joe Burrow's the new thing. He's the new good thing, blah, blah, blah. Joe Burrow completed 46% of his passes against Miami, 44% of his passes against Auburn, 56% against Bama, 51% against Florida, whatever. The guy, he can't complete passes. He can't complete passes against anybody with a pulse. And then he plays against some rat team, and he's like 25-26. And everybody's like, oh, Joe Burrow, do it against somebody good. He's a career 57% passer. Joe Burrow. He's going to burrow his head in the ground. That's what he's going to do. They call him Joe Gopher. Joe Gopher. Do you know what LSU fans use for birth control? Their personalities. Never been against Tom Herman. Ed Orgeron is an absolute clown. If you bet on him, you deserve what you get. It, too, ain't going to be the only thing with a clown in it this weekend. And there is one reason more important than Tom Herman, the underdog king, more important than It Too, the Ed Orgeron show, more important than Joe Burrow becoming Joe Gopher. Sam Ellinger. Sam Ellinger. The greatest quarterback on God's green earth. Sam Ellinger from Tombstone, he's coming, hell's coming with him, and Sam Ellinger. Texas +6.5, but we don't need them. We're taking Texas straight off. It's a boot game! Sam Ellinger's gonna stick his boot in their friggin' ass! Texas straight up over LSU! It's my boot game of the year! Last game, NFL. The Patriots and Bill Belichick against the spread against Mike Tomlin are 11-4-1. Tom Brady is like 25-1 against the number. Friggin' mustache. Tom Brady is like 25-1 against the number at home, against a winning team if he's favored by less than a touchdown. 25-1. You get the line at less than a touchdown if you go get on it now. Go get on it now. Go. Stop watching the friggin' video and get on the game right now. It's a winner. Texas, UCLA, Central Florida, the Patriots, and then bet another bunch of crap. Bet everything that you want. People will say, use money management. Listen, there is one way to get ahead in life, and that is to gamble irresponsibly. That's it. That's the only way. Texas, Patriots, UCLA, Central Florida, 4-0. You're welcome. Have a great weekend. Sam Ellinger! Sam Ellinger! Sam Ellinger!